So, you want to learn how to create your very own homebrew campaign, or you're just tired of running the same boxed campaigns that everybody else is running. Well, this is the video for you. Nothing is more exciting than a campaign that is fresh, new, and that could lead anywhere. My name is Tom Tobar, and welcome to Behind the Screen, a Game Master's Guide. This is a show where I take you behind my Game Master screen, and I share some of my favorite tips, some tricks, some tools, and some toys that I'm using to become a better Game Master. In this episode, I went into detail on how to formulate your very own homebrew campaign idea. In my last video, I outlined how to turn that idea into a one-shot campaign. Now it's time to take what we worked on in those episodes and expand it into a multi-session campaign. If you've not already seen those previous videos, it is highly recommended that you go back and check them out before continuing. If you're all caught up, let's get ourselves started. One-shot campaigns can be a lot of fun, but sometimes they can leave your players feeling a bit unsatisfied. Players often fall in love with the new characters that they build, or the story that you're telling. Just when everything starts to come together, the story's over, and everybody has to go home. Well, today, I'm going to give you some practical steps that you can use to turn your one-shot campaign ideas into multi-session campaigns. Just like before, I'm going to be building my own pirate campaign that I've been building alongside you in this series. The first thing that we need to talk about is how to lay out your multi-session campaign. Multi-session campaigns are built from a series of shorter story arcs, all centered around one overarching story. This layout is not a new idea, and it's not unique to tabletop games. Many multi-part books, TV shows, movies, they all use the same kind of a layout. Both story arcs and the overarching story are built from elements of plot. Now, I've gone over plot in a lot of detail in my previous videos, but as a quick reminder, here are the elements of plot. Each of these elements are needed to build an engaging, organized, and cohesive story. For a more detailed explanation, watch this video right over here. Let's briefly look at the Harry Potter series as an example of how to lay out story arcs within an overarching story, using the elements of plot. Now, there are 7 books in the Harry Potter series, each with their own mini stories, people, struggles, and most importantly, each has their own plot. There is, however, only one overarching story plot running through all of the books. This plot centers on the idea that Voldemort's goal is to be reborn, gain control, kill Harry Potter, and control the world. Let's look at all the books together to see how they all interact with this one singular overarching plot outline. Book number 1, exposition and conflict. You're a wizard, Harry, with a powerful enemy that's not as dead as everybody believes. Book number 2, rising action. Voldemort tries and fails to come back. Book number 3, Voldemort gets the helper that he needs to get things done. Book number 4, Voldemort is back, but no one believes that he is. Book number 5, Voldemort gains more power, but in the shadows. Book number 6, Voldemort kills his biggest rival and starts looking for the Deathly Hallows. This is even before Harry knows what's going on. Book number 7, Book number 7 has the climax, the falling action, and the resolution all within that one book. Voldemort gains all the power that he thinks that he needs to win. However, Harry wins in the end. Harry gets married, settles down, has kids, and has a normal life. If this were a campaign, each of these books would be considered its own campaign arc. Each arc has its own self-contained plot. In other words, each book on its own has its own problem, journey, climax, and resolution. Each arc as a whole needs to push the overarching story forward in some way. Sometimes these plot movements are really big, and sometimes they're small. but they always need to be moving things forward. When writing your own multi-session campaign, it's important to keep eyes on the overarching story plot while you're writing your individual story arcs. When starting writing a new arc, be sure to ask yourself the following questions. Number one, why is this story arc important to the overarching story plot? Number two, what does the main bad guy hope to gain during this arc? Keep in mind that even if the players don't see the main bad guy in this arc, it doesn't mean that they're on pause somewhere. It means that they're always looking for ways to take advantage of the situation, or they're trying to do something in order to achieve their goals. Finally, what are all the individual plot points for this story arc? You want each arc to feel complete in some way, and so in order to do this, you have to use the elements of plot, so it needs to have a very clear beginning, middle, and end. Now let's apply this model to our own campaigns. Like before, I'll be building off my pirate campaign so you can see what choices I make. Here is a quick refresher of what I had planned for my overarching story plot. Exposition and conflict. The pirates need to save their captain. Therefore, the pirates go on a job to go into a forgotten tomb. They eventually find a hidden chest. However, when they open the chest, they accidentally free a god of monsters in the process. Now, that god wants to gain her former power and destroy the world with her monster children. Rising action. To gain more power, Lilith needs her body to be freed from mirror fragments that have been scattered across the world. Climax. Lilith will either gain the power that she needs, or she'll be stopped by the players. Falling action and resolution. Not sure yet what to do with these pieces. This largely depends on what the players do throughout their campaign. This is the overarching story plot for my campaign. For the most part, every individual story arc and the sessions that I play at the table need to be centered on this plot, just like the Harry Potter example. In my last video, I was able to take care of the exposition and the climax in my one shot that I built. Now I need to create arc 2 of my campaign. Before I get started in developing the details, I need to answer those new arc questions. Number one, why is this story arc important to the overarching story plot? My players need direction on what to do to solve the problem that they created. I'll do this by having the two good gods who originally trapped Lilith in the chest provide the players with all the information that they need. My players also have been cursed by this whole experience. I'll also need to help them understand how to make use of these new cursed powers. Number two, what does the main bad guy hope to gain during this arc? Lilith's main goal right now is to find the mirror fragments her body is trapped inside. She will be awakening her monster children all over the world in order to set them out looking for these mirror fragments. I like the idea that groups of monsters have been trapped behind some kind of magical seals in different locations around the world. Her focus will be on breaking these seals. Number three, finally, what are all the plot points for this story arc? Exposition, get the players to the temple to learn all about how to solve the problem and learn about their powers. Conflict, in order for the party to fully communicate with the god and get the information that they need, they'll need to destroy all the enemies inside the temple. Rising action, good old fashioned dungeon diving. I can also place some helpful information in the temple that can provide some additional lore for my players. Climax. A possessed townsperson has been inhabited by an evil, powerful monster spirit. He will act as a commander of all the monsters. This commander is currently trying to create a portal to join Lilith and follow her commands. Players will also need to fight this mini-boss. If they win, the spirit will leave the body and he'll try to find another one to replace it. If they lose, well, then the commander will just complete the portal and join Lilith. At this point, I've already made a pretty good outline for my next arc of my campaign. I, however, do not want to railroad my players into following it exactly, so I need to set up a few options that can help guide them to where they want to go. Here are a few possible arc 2 beginning places for my players. Option number one, revisit the town and the temple. The players might want to see the abandoned town and temple for themselves. No need to push them at all. In order to prepare for this, I'll need to have a few things prepared ahead of time. For example, some low-level monsters ready to do battle with, some directions from the good gods on what to do next. The commander will need a stat block, maybe a few puzzles to throw into the dungeon as well. Option number two, refugee information. The most obvious course of action that my players might choose to take is to go see the refugees that just all made it into town. This means I need to make a few NPCs of refugees and explain how they escaped. Having a few specific stories about the escape can really make this threat come to life. In order to help guide my players back to the temple, I can give everybody who's been cursed dreams of a ghost-like voice calling to them from inside the temple. I also need to think about the impact the refugees will have on the town itself. My players won't be the only people asking them questions. For inspiration, I can look at how refugees are treated in the real world. Some people will be very welcoming, and other people will be a little hostile. The mayor of the town will most likely have to have a response of some kind. He'll most likely have to make a statement on the welfare of the town and the welfare of the refugees. And this means I need to have a few more names of NPCs ready to go as well, for townspeople and the mayor, of course. For extra flavor in my campaign, I plan to have a woman who is openly hostile to the refugees. At the beginning of the campaign, she is only able to influence a few people to her cause. For the most part, people in the town are pretty welcoming and kind. As the campaign progresses, however, she will win over more and more of the townspeople by spreading rumors and creating fear. This means there will most likely be a campaign arc in the future where the players will have to come back and save the refugees from the townspeople. Find the patron who sent them on this quest to begin with. Nemo, the handler, had been given this quest to find and open the chest from someone. I'll need to develop a name and a backstory for that person. I think that this would most likely be a scholar of some kind, who just wanted to be the first to discover something. The poor fool wouldn't know much about the situation, but he'd be useful to help the party gain more information as they find more writings and do some research. He would also most likely want to be shown more items from the temple to help them understand the situation better. This would also push the players back to revisiting the temple. Option 4. Players leave the town and just run away. Yes, the players could do this, but it's probably the least likely. However, if they really wanted to do this, they could be found by monsters in any of these areas that they run to. With these four options planned out in more detail, of course, I'm sure I could run the next few sessions in this next arc of my adventure. In the end, no matter what my players choose to do first, I'm sure they'll eventually do each of these options at some point in the future. For this reason, never feel upset at your players for doing the unexpected. Once my players complete this new arc of the campaign, I'll do the same exact exercise all over again to plan out next steps. This will not go on forever because I'll always be looking at the overarching story plot. Lilith will always be reacting and adjusting to my players' actions. She is focused on getting closer and closer to her goals. There are three models to choose from when building a multi-session campaign: plot-driven campaigns, character-centered campaigns, and epic campaigns. The plot-driven campaign model, or pre-built campaigns, are often what you see from publishers at game stores. Pre-built adventures are great because they're mostly plug and play. Plug in your players and start reading from each one of the room's description boxes. It doesn't really matter what the players choose to play, the adventurer will, for the most part, be the same. There is nothing wrong with a plot-driven campaign. In fact, many game masters let the publishers of these adventures do all the heavy lifting for them. For example, the world building, creating the art, and building the maps. This way, the game master can tailor these worlds with additional custom elements. From a campaign builder's perspective, which is why you're all here, they're built with a deep world building perspective and not at all from a player's perspective. The biggest downside to building a plot-driven campaign is that they require a lot of planning that can sometimes take years to complete. And in many ways, they railroad their players into following the following path. If I were to continue building my pirate campaign the way I've been doing it, it would be considered a plot-driven campaign. The second campaign style is a character-centered campaign. This is where the entirety of the campaign is built from the players and their backstories. So, when a player says to you that as a child, a ruthless gang came and killed everyone that they have ever loved, then the entirety of the campaign is centered around that idea. This style is difficult to build because you're not even able to start developing anything until the players have built their characters and developed their backstories. Once all the characters and backstories have been built, then you need to find a way of weaving all these stories together into one campaign. In many cases, you're not able to even plan that far ahead because you need to react to the player's choices and their personal character development. Even though this campaign style is difficult to build, it is well worth the effort. Nothing is more exciting to a player than a story that's all about themselves. My pirate campaign would not be categorized as a character-centered campaign because there is a central plot that exists outside of the characters themselves. The final campaign style is what I call an epic campaign. This is a blend of the plot-driven campaign and the character-centered campaigns. This is my personal favorite and what I'm going to be doing for my pirate campaign. I love telling stories with great plot and then interweaving all of my characters' backstories deeply into it. When it's done correctly, the players will feel like they have real stakes in the story instead of just adventurers completing a job. Time to show you how I'm building an epic pirate campaign. When doing this, it's important to remember two main questions. Number one, what are easy fits where the overarching story plot could directly match the backstory? Then, number two, how can this backstory connection be integrated into the larger ongoing plot of the story? Since I don't have actual players for this campaign, I'll be using the backstories of popular characters from movies and pretend that they're characters in my campaign. I'm going to be using Marlin from Finding Nemo, Harry Potter from Harry Potter, and Aragorn from The Lord of the Rings. Marlin has lost his son and is now on a quest to go and find him. Number one, what are some easy fits where the overarching story plot could directly match the backstory? Since Marlin is looking for his son, I need to separate them in a dramatic way. Marlin and his son were in the town when it was overrun by invisible monsters. It is because of his time spent as an adventurer that he was able to save a lot of people from the monsters. It was also Marlin's idea to get everybody onto boats and to sail away. However, as they were making their escape, a large invisible tentacle came out of the water and grabbed his son and carried him away. Marlin was unable to go after his son because he was soon after knocked out. Marlin believes his son is still alive because the monster did not immediately kill him like it had everybody else. Instead, it looked like it came after the boat for the son. I already made a possessed townsperson in the temple called the commander. I can change this element slightly and make the son the possessed townsperson. I could easily make this the first arc of the story, rescuing the son. However, once it was completed, the player would feel bored with the rest of the campaign as their part in the story would already be complete. This is why the next question is so vitally important. Question two, how can this backstory connection be integrated into the larger ongoing plot of the story? Due to the boy's age, he was able to take on a lot more of the curse than anybody else that was infected. Because of this, he was the best candidate to house the commander's evil spirit. Because I want the boy to live, I'll change the mini boss fight that I had previously made. I want the fight to be with the commander's servants instead of the boy himself. If the party defeats the servants but fails to do it in time, the commander will escape. If they defeat the servants in time, then they will have a possessed boy to take care of with no means to change him back. Well, yet, anyways. I want the commander to escape, so I'll make it a higher level of difficulty to succeed this. In many future arcs, regardless if he escapes or not, the possessed boy is becoming more and more monstrous and creating more and more of a problem for the players. Now, the players won't just have the simple option of just finding the sun. Now the players will have to internally wrestle with, can the sun truly be saved? Or will they have to just stop him instead? Are you beginning to see why epic campaigns are epic? Harry Potter backstory. Harry found out late in life that he was a wizard. Also, he found out that he was responsible for the death of a powerful wizard known as Voldemort. Now he fears the return of this wizard. What are some easy fits where the overarching story plot could directly match the backstory? The evil wizard Voldemort is powerful because he learned old magics that Lilith had left behind. Without a body to use, his spirit was lost for years, holding on to life in dark and evil places. When the chest was finally opened by the pirates, the spirit came out and inhabited the body of a boy with more than average magic and cursed powers. He now inhabits the body of Marlin's son. By combining these two backstories like this, I have created a complex relationship between the players and the overarching story. Harry will most likely want to kill Voldemort, while Marlin will most likely want to save his son. Because of this complex relationship and somewhat conflicting goals, it is sure to create some amazing moments at the table. How can this backstory connection be integrated into the larger ongoing plot of the story? In addition to Marlin's connection, I can add that Voldemort also wants to torment Harry, in addition to killing him in very painful and creative ways. Aragorn's backstory. Born an heir to a large kingdom, Aragorn was raised by elves in ignorance of his heritage. When he became of age, he learned of his birthright, but had no desire to become king. Aragorn has fear that he would go mad, just like his ancestors before him. Question number one. What are easy fits where the overarching story plot could directly match the backstory? Aragorn worries about being corrupted. Well, there's already a curse going around in my game. There is an issue, however, with the timing. If the chest was open and that's what started the curse, then how could Aragorn's ancestors already have the curse? Answer. Aragorn learns that the same curse afflicting the heroes and the townspeople is the same one that has been on his family for years. It was this curse that is directly responsible for his family's madness. The truth, that he will learn about in later acts, is that his family has been hiding one of the pieces of the mirror that contains the body of Lilith. An overexposure to the mirror fragment is what gave Aragorn's family the curse early on and drove them all mad. Number two, how can this backstory connection be integrated into the larger ongoing plot of the story? As Lilith gains more and more power, she begins to take over the kingdom that once belonged to her. Aragorn will feel an obligation to protect his former kingdom. Also, only someone of royal lineage will be able to access the protected mirror still hidden somewhere inside the castle. As far as the curse, if the mirror fragments make people mad, if they stay too close to them, then that means every step the players take towards collecting all the mirror fragments and eventually destroying Lilith is a step closer into madness. Aragorn will have a lot of conflicting feelings about this and collecting the fragments and keeping them safe. Thoughtfully considering player backstories and integrating them into the overall plot can take some time. And it's common to have your players' backstories change your original plot outlines. For example, I did not plan on creating the commander until it was after I looked at Marlin's backstory. Personally, I love the mental exercise of mixing plot and backstories. And I love the look on my players' faces when they're really engaged in an epic story that I'm telling. Now it's time for you to work on your own multi-session campaign. As you get started, you're gonna face a pretty big obstacle. Nothing is more intimidating than an empty page. It doesn't matter if you're a seasoned veteran or you're brand new to world building, an empty page is a formidable enemy. Where each content creator approaches this issue differently, I'm gonna share what works for me. My philosophy is that it's always easier to start from something than from nothing. With that in mind, I will briefly share two of my favorite methods for getting inspiration and helping me with the empty page problem. Music. Music is one of the most amazing tools that you can use to help frame your campaign around. I've centered many of my past campaigns around an album or even a single song. For example, when I ran an Icewind Dale campaign, I used a soundtrack from a game called Frostpunk. Keep in mind, I have never played the game Frostpunk. I was just searching online for game soundtracks with a winter theme. When I found the album, I found it to be captivating, and I would often listen to it when I was writing my campaign notes. Listening to an album while you're writing helped me get immersed into the Icewind Dale landscape, and it, in turn, helped me write a better adventure. The benefit of using an album from a specific game is that there is usually a wide range of songs, from calming to exciting. Because I listened to the album so much, I was able to use specific songs during my game that all matched the mood I was trying to set at the table. If you're not streaming your game online and don't need to worry about copyright, I highly encourage you to find an album that works for you. Another great tool to use is an image library like Pinterest or one of the many AI image generators. Doing some random searching online for character art, locations, and maps is a great way to fill the empty pages in your notes and help you get inspired. It's easier to see an image and imagine a story surrounding it than it is to come up with every single thing on your own. Where I love using online art to show my players settings and character profiles, researching and generating all these images can take a lot of time. For this reason, I use my Patreon subscriptions to do a lot of the heavy lifting for me. I'll go into detail about these subscriptions that I use in later videos. However, for now, here's one Patreon that I would suggest for beginners. Zen Maps. Zen Maps does a lot of building and generating on your behalf so that you don't have to. The reason I suggest this creator instead of others is because they give full packages that center on a specific theme, and their themes are very wide in range. In each pack, you get character art, location art, monster art, token art, battle maps, and a whole bunch more. Currently, a subscription to Zen Maps costs about $2 a month, and you get access to all the packs that they've built so far. If you're struggling to come up with some location details and ideas for your story, then using a Patreon pack provider like Zen Maps can easily provide you the quick tools and inspiration for the story that you need. Understand, I am in no way being sponsored by Zen Maps. In fact, I'm the one supporting them by being subscribed to their Patreon. I honestly believe that for the amount of time that it saves me, $2 is a great deal. For my friends starting out as a homebrew game master, or for those who want to get started using a TV or a projector for their battle maps, this is a cheap and comprehensive package to help you get started. I have a link in the video description below to help you check them out firsthand if you want to. If you want to see more advanced maps and the tools that I use for my games, then check out our later videos as well. Speaking of sponsorships, if you found this tutorial to be helpful, be sure to hit that like and subscribe button down below. Showing your support is always very much appreciated. All right, I believe you have everything you need to get started building your own homebrew multi-session campaign that has the potential of being truly epic. Join us in our next episode, Tools and Toys Using Digital Maps. In that episode, I'll show you many of the digital map tools that I use, the softwares that I use to make them come to life, and I can show you some cheap ways to make your own digital game board for yourself. Until then, I'm Tom Tobar, and I'll see you next time behind the screen.